Community Church. It's so good to see everyone here this morning. My name is Alex. I want to invite you to stand with us, and it's Palm Sunday. If you didn't know, Palm Sunday is the first day of one of the most, I would say, the most important weeks of history. It was when Jesus came as a king, but not the king that people were expecting. He came as a servant. And so I just want to pray for us this morning as we enter into this time of worship. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you today. We thank you for the sunshine, and we thank you for this amazing reminder as we reflect on you coming to Jerusalem, Jesus, you coming and preparing to do something that your disciples at the time weren't expecting. You're preparing to die, to give yourself as a sacrifice on the cross for us. We just thank you this morning that we have a king on a throne who reigns forever, who is a servant king, who came to do what we couldn't do. We just thank you, Jesus. We praise you this morning. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Let's declare that this morning.
Salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. Yes, we believe. Oh, oh, I believe in the crucifixion. By his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection, hallelujah, his life is destiny. Let's sing all praise. Oh, praise to God the Father. Oh, praise to Christ the Son. Oh, praise to the Holy Spirit. How God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name, I believe. I believe, I believe. Yeah. I believe in the hope of heaven. He's preparing a place for me, far beyond what hearts imagine, ears have heard or eyes have seen. I believe that a day is coming. He's returning to claim his bride. Light the altar, keep it burning. See a lamp who rose a roaring lion. All praise. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. Oh, praise to the Holy Spirit. How God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name, I believe.
Let's declare that there's nothing that can stand against our God.
No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. No, I'll never walk away from the one who saved my life.
Let's sing that again.
No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? Of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life?
Let's declare this morning all praise.
All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. How God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name I believe. All praise. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. How God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name I believe. Yeah. In Jesus' mighty name I believe. Yeah. I believe. Yes, we do. Oh, I believe. Yes, we do. We believe in you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus.
the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. So great a mercy, what heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living Lord. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Lost his grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. Broken every chain, there's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living Lord. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body.
my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. Wanna sing? So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. All that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Got one response. I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah. I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Ooh, yeah. Hallelujah. It's all I have, I'll sing. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Let's declare that this morning. Come on. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. You got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Even if there's no words to say, even if we don't know what to express to you, God. We know that all that you want is our hearts. All that you want is our yes. So, God, this morning, we just simply say yes to you. We say yes to your word. We say yes to your call, Jesus, to follow you, our servant king. We love you. It's in your mighty name that we pray. Amen. Well, it was wonderful getting to worship with you guys this morning. Before you take a seat, why don't you say good morning to someone, give someone a high five or fist bump or hug. We'll have announcements up here in just a second.
Good morning, everybody. My name's Pat. I'm one of the ushers here at VCC. I also sub in to Kidsmen once in a while and do the fun stuff with Awake. In the back of the seat back in front of you, you'll find our connect cards and prayer cards. If you need prayer and want to get more info about who we are or get involved, just fill one out. You can bring the prayer card to the box on the back counter. If it's your first time joining us, please bring your Connect card out to the Welcome Center and we'll have a gift for you at the end of the service. For tithes and offerings, you can give physically in the red box in the back at the end of the service or give online at victorchurch.org. If you're visiting, we're just glad you're here, so please find no obligation to give. That's the responsibility of those that call VCC home. This Friday, we have a multi-church Good Friday service. We're so excited to remind you that we will be hosting this from 6:30 to 7:30, Friday the 29th. We can't wait to come together as one body to worship our Savior and reflect on a sacrifice for us. The night is for the whole family. We look forward to seeing you all come out and seeing you there. Next thing I got for you is the Unshakable Youth Worship Night. Our student ministry is teaming up with other local youth groups for an amazing night of worship here at VCC. If you're in 6th through 12th grade, bring a friend along. Come out. It'll be April 14th, 6 to 8:30. Join us at 6 o'clock for free pizza. Ooh, I think I'm coming. Hangout time, and that'll lead into a full night of guided worship. If you've never been to a worship night before, they promise it's going to be awesome. The goal is for students to see that you're not alone in their faith, to stroke their fire in God, and to equip them to go into your schools and share the gospel. The set list for that night is fire. It's been on repeat in my house for a while. It's going to be a fun night. Make sure you come on out. Marriage retreat reminders. It's hard to believe that the marriage retreat is next month. If you haven't registered, you have until April 7th to get registered and pay. If you plan to attend, please call ASAP to reserve your room. If you have already booked your room but not registered, please do that soon. You can do that by visiting the homepage at victorchurch.org or scanning the QR code. For those of you who have registered and still need to pay or when you go to pay, I was just told that if you go to the Church Center app or victorchurch.org and click on the Giving tab, click on One Time, and then in the drop-down menu for the fund, there is a marriage retreat option. So you can pay online just like you do with your giving, make it easier for you.
Yeah.
For all these and more, check out our bulletin.
Yeah, thanks, Pat. You know, the marriage retreat, as you mentioned, there's two places that we want you to tell us you're coming. One is call the hotel, make sure you have a room. The second is to register here through the church and make sure we've got both of those covered. If you call the hotel, you want to make sure you mention VCC or ask for Carrie. Carrie is the one that's helping us out. We have a special rate. So if you just go online, like, you know, whatever, cheap hotel, find me a room.com or whatever, we get a better rate. So you want to make sure you call and utilize that. Hey, I got a quick update for you. It's very short update. Doug and Donna Allen are home back in New York. So, yeah. It's great news. They made it home, I believe, Thursday, and just kind of settling back in. So thanks for continuing to pray for them. And I'm sure some have asked about, well, could I send a card out to California? Please don't do that anymore, because it's going to find its way back to New York. But so happy that that progress has been made, and glad to share that with you. We're going to continue this morning talking about the ministry years of Jesus' life. As we talked about 2 weeks ago, we kind of broke this down into three main sections: the year of inauguration, his baptism, early ministry, wedding miracle at Cana, some of those early things where Jesus was kind of getting out there publicly, right? His ministry years, we call that the year of inauguration. Then last week we talked about what we've called the year of popularity. It was just when, you know, his notoriety, his travel through the region was happening, and really a year of popularity. And then today, we want to spend some time talking about what's leading up to, including a year of opposition. And it's not as if Jesus couldn't continue to do things. He certainly continued his ministry, but as we come now to this year of opposition, that is going to lead up to his betrayal, his arrest, his crucifixion, which we will all remember on Friday. Hope that you can be here. As Pat mentioned, it's a celebration, a remembrance we do with other churches in the area. We happen to host it, so be here at 6:30. We'll focus specifically on the crucifixion and what Jesus did on the cross. But all of this is leading up to that, right? And so Jesus continued his public ministry. If we were to go through, we'd see, for instance, since our last time talking, that he fed thousands on multiple occasions, by the way, more than once, that he walked out on the water to the disciples as they were out on a boat, that the transfiguration occurred. There's the raising of Lazarus from the dead. There's the healing of people in different situations. So the public ministry is continuing. And if you're willing this morning to spend some time in God's word, are you okay with that? All right, Mark. We're going to be in the Gospel of Mark. A couple of weeks ago, we were in John. We've been in Matthew. We'll hit all the Gospels. We'll be in Luke next Sunday. But Mark, and we're going to pick it up at chapter 8. So in Mark chapter 8, I really want to highlight what I see the focus being, and the shift of focus as we go from that year of popularity into the year of opposition. So we're not going to track everything that happens, but I want to point us to four passages that I think are really significant for us to consider as we understand the bigger picture of the ministry life of Christ, all right? And so Mark chapter 8, and if we were to look back a little bit, I'm going to pick it up at verse 27, but in Mark chapter 8, we see a couple of really cool things happen. Jesus feeds thousands, he heals a man who's blind, and then he's traveling now with the disciples. So we pick it up at verse 27. Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" Very honest question, right? They're traveling. Ministry's been going great. Lots of, as we've said, the year of popularity. Lots of things happening. And Jesus asks them what seems like a very simple question, but man, is it a loaded question. And we'll see why in just a minute. But here's the question. Who do people say I am? What's the word on the street, disciples? What's the buzz that you're hearing? You know, if he were to ask that today, he might say, how am I trending? Who do people say that I am? And they replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets. In other words, well, there's a few different opinions out there. A few different opinions. And one of the things that we recognize is that there is such a thing as popular opinion even back then. Right? We talk about things in terms of the popular opinion, but even back in the time of Jesus, as he's doing public ministry with the disciples, there was this thing called popular opinion. And that's what Jesus was asking about. What's the popular opinion? And it's split. Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets. And when Jesus asked that first question, I think he was really laying the groundwork for a much more significant question. Because he doesn't even address the popular opinion. right? I mean, the disciples respond, well, some say this, some say this, some say this, and he doesn't address that at all. He simply goes to the very next question, which is, but what about you? Who do you say I am? And that is the most significant question. It's the more significant question in this dialogue here with the disciples, but in reality, it is the most significant question we can ask ourselves. Who do we say Jesus is? What's the conclusion we've come to about Jesus? And let's be honest, some of the popular opinion of today is, oh, he was a really good teacher. Well, he was an historical figure back in the day, but beyond that, I don't know or care much about beyond that. And still others would say, well, he was the Messiah. He was the Son of God. He was the promised one that God provided for the salvation of mankind. So Peter responds to this question. You are the Christ. In other Gospels, give more detail in terms of Jesus really commending Peter for recognizing and verbalizing who Jesus is. It's interesting because of what happens immediately following. We'll talk about that in just a second. But Peter answers the question, you are the Christ. He clearly identifies Jesus as the Messiah, the Christ, the one that God was going to send. Peter verbalizes, in a sense, maybe for all the disciples, but at least for himself, this is who I think you are. And as I said, Peter is commended for that. And we certainly live in a day and age when sometimes what's popular or simply looking through the lens of popularity, it's hard to determine. And truth, honestly, seems at times even more elusive in the wake of popular opinion. But Peter nails it. Peter says, you are the Christ. And then an interesting thing happens. Verse 30, Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. Does this strike anybody as interesting? I mean, here, what, public, didn't last week we read that he sent them out to preach the good news? What is this? What? Something doesn't seem to fit here. Well, specifically, and other Gospels bring this out maybe more specifically, but specifically he's talking about the title of Christ, not to tell anyone that he is the Christ. If you remember, last week when he sent them out, they were to preach the good news of the gospel. They were to preach about the kingdom. What's the specificity about not telling anyone, identifying him as the Christ? Well, most a popular opinion, many Jewish folks of that day were looking for the Messiah, but they were looking for the Christ. They were looking for the one who would be more of a political leader in that day and age. One who would provide for the freedom from the Roman Empire. So to find Jesus and to clearly identify him as the Christ, I think we could surmise that the reason Jesus warned them is because that would have been a distraction to what he was really about. It would be a distraction and potentially would encourage folks to revolt against the Roman Empire in that particular time. That's not what Jesus was there to accomplish, right? He wasn't there to accomplish a political overthrow, a political coup. It was a spiritual war that he was fighting. And so he said, let's just not identify me. Don't tell anyone that. You're right, but let's not publicize that in a broad way right now. So what is Jesus doing here? You see, because I think there's a transition that we're going to notice. There's a transition that we're going to notice, and we noticed it kind of last week when we said, now Jesus is preparing them to go out and do the ministry as opposed to the first year. But now here's a transition where he's really pointing towards the end goal, the end purpose, and that is his death on the cross and his resurrection. And so what happens? Well, we're going to slide right into the next section here, verses 31 through 38. And I've just, in the outline here, just to the cross. That's what Jesus is talking about. I'm going to the cross. Notice what he says. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders. By the way, you see that title, Son of Man, there? Notice just previously he had warned the disciples, don't tell anyone I'm the Christ. In fact, Jesus rarely used that title of himself, the Christ. Son of Man was the one that he used most often in the Gospels. And so we see that right here in the following verses. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this. Jesus now is trying to get them focused, trying to help them understand, listen, this is not about a political overthrow, but I'm headed to the cross. That's the point. And I want you to understand what's about to happen. He was trying to point them and allow them to see the bigger picture there. He spoke plainly about this. He was trying to keep them up to speed. An interesting thing happens in the second half of verse 32. It says, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. And I wish, there's some points in history, aren't there points in history you wish you could just like be a fly on the wall, right? Just, you know, I'd love to, that's one of those, when you have a bunch of people together, it's one of those icebreaker questions. If you could be anywhere at any point in history, where would you be and why, right? But I've got a bunch of those, and you probably do as well. This is one of those, I don't know how high on the list it would be, but I'd love to be a fly on the wall to see Peter taking Jesus aside and rebuking him. Like, to me, that's just, hey, Jesus, come here, I gotta straighten you out on something here, you know? And it's not unlike Peter's personality to maybe be a little bit, you know, not spontaneous. What's that other word? What? Impulsive. There you go. Perfect. Thank you for that. And that's, I suppose, one of the reasons why Peter is one of those biblical figures that when people are asked, who do you identify with in Scripture? Peter's one that's high on many people's list. And sometimes I'm just impulsive here. But so Peter takes Jesus aside, and he begins to rebuke him. But what is he rebuking him about? Well, obviously, he's rebuking him about what he just heard, right? So here's Peter rebuking him. In other words, saying like, hey, Jesus, we don't have the words here. All right, so I'm somewhat speculating on the conversation, but I think it's something along the lines of, hey, Jesus, like, that's not a good plan. Let's not do that. There's no way you should be doing that. Jesus, you should not be going to the cross, is basically what he was saying. And Jesus was just trying to get the disciples to be up to speed on the bigger picture of, I'm going to the cross. This is one of the whole points of what we're doing. I'm going to be the sacrifice for mankind. And Peter pulls him aside and says, I'm not sure I'm on board with that plan. So verse 33, when Jesus turned and looked at the disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan, he said. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. So what did Jesus do? Well, it looks like he called Peter Satan. But what he's really saying, he's not calling him Satan, but what he's really saying is, Peter, like, that's Satan's plan, that's not my plan, right? And we see that actually previous. Satan's temptation to have Jesus get off track, we see in the temptation in the wilderness, right? Oh, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? And each time Jesus responded, he withstood that test of temptation in the wilderness. But here again, Peter's kind of referencing that Jesus is referencing that Peter's, you know, encouragement to him, his rebuke of him, is not God's plan, but that would be Satan's plan. Don't go to the cross. Don't do what you're supposed to do. And he says to Peter, "You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." And isn't that so true? That oftentimes we see things through the lens of the way things are humanly or here on this earth. We just see through that lens. And sometimes it's because it's the only lens we have. And sometimes it's because we just haven't quite tuned into everything God has for us. And that's what Jesus was trying to do with the disciples. And Peter isn't quite up to speed. And Peter's rebuke against going to the cross to die was as much against God's plan as Satan's temptation was in the wilderness. He says to Peter, you're thinking about this from the wrong terms, through the wrong lens. You're looking at this through human eyes, but you need to have spiritual eyes. You need to be looking at this through the mind and the things of God. And I think, man, what a great lesson this is for us. What a great lesson. How often would our view of, think about something that you've been dealing with or dealt with in the last maybe week or month, or you know, it's right in front of you in the next week or month. How would your view of that change if you could only see it through God's lens? And that's one of the great challenges we have as people, isn't it? To understand how God views things, what the bigger picture is according to God's plan, how that view would change if we could just shift lenses. And sometimes God gives us the opportunity to do that. Sometimes when we spend time looking, studying God's word, when we get the counsel of godly wisdom, when we spend time praying and seeking the Holy Spirit's direction for something, those lenses can shift and change, and we can begin to see a picture bigger than we initially saw on our own. And God gives us that insight into things. You know, sometimes we'll be praying for something, and we'll say, God made it clear to me. Right? What is that? Well, think about that. Clarity literally is the lens has shifted, right? How many of you have these? Right? You know, when I put the right lens on, things become a lot clearer. Right? And we even say it that way. I was praying about this and God made it clear to me. What does that mean? Somehow God's work in your life shifted the lenses so you could see it the way God wanted you to see it. Right? And then I think there are other times where God says, you're not going to see everything, but I've given you enough that you can trust me. I've given you enough that you should be able to trust me in this. You know, how many times as parents do we use that phrase? Not the phrase because I said so, but the phrase, just trust me on this, right? Why? Because as parents, we oftentimes, especially when the kids are younger, we see a much bigger picture than they have the ability to see. And part of what our job is as parents is to help them see a bigger picture as they grow and develop, right? But there are times where we say, just, I want you to trust me on this. There should be enough relationally going on that you can trust me. And I think God says the very same thing. And so as we see this conversation with Jesus and the disciples, and then specifically Peter, there's just the reminder as Jesus is trying to get them to see that bigger picture of, hey, I'm going to the cross. Jesus has this conversation to help shift Peter's lens a little bit. Sometimes I think we need that as well. Jump ahead to Mark chapter 10. In Mark chapter 10, before we get there, Jesus again in Mark chapter 9 predicted his death in a very quick, way, in chapter 9, verse 31. But we get to chapter 10, verse 32, and again, Jesus predicts his death. If we look at chapter 10, and as I said, 32 and 33 and 34, here's what we find. They were on their way up to Jerusalem, with Jesus leading the way, and the disciples were astonished, while those who followed were afraid. So the disciples were astonished at what was happening, and there were other people who were a little bit freaked out by what was happening. And it says, again, he took the 12 aside and told them what was going to happen to him. Again, what's the focus of Jesus with the disciples here in this season of ministry? He's letting them know, hey, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to go to the cross. I want you to know I'm going to go to the cross. I want you to know I'm going to go to the cross. And if we were to fast forward, and some of you have, you know the story. When Jesus went to the cross, the disciples had, every one of them had a crisis of faith. So he's preparing them for that season, right? He's preparing them by letting them know this is what's going to happen. You know, I think in some ways, if he could summarize that, he might say, listen, guys, don't be surprised. This should not come as a shock to you, right? But here's what we find. Verse 32. I'm sorry, verse 33. We are going up to Jerusalem. Here's the game plan, guys. We're heading to Jerusalem, and here's what's going to happen. And man, he gives some detail here, like very specific detail. And the Son of Man, there's that title again, right? Jesus most often referred to himself as the Son of Man in the Gospels, will be betrayed to the chief priests and teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him, and kill him. And if we were to fast forward and study the events of the final week, which is, as we've talked about, is really the week that we're at, right? And we'll finish this morning, we'll talk about his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, but then that week, all those things then played out according to exactly what Jesus told the disciples. 3 days later, he will rise. So again, he takes the 12 aside. His desire is to prepare them for what was going to happen, and it seems obvious he's trying to prepare them. But in the following verses, it's clear that they're not quite getting it all yet, right? Because after he says that, hey, this is what's going to happen, we find in the verses following that James and John, sons of Zebedee, two of the 12 disciples, teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. Now, I don't get the impression here that this thrilled Jesus. In fact, he says in verse 38, you don't know what you're asking. But we don't see the impression that he's just really, really aggravated with them. But there seems to be a like, come on, guys. What are you talking about? Because what he says, okay, what do you want me to do? Let one of us sit on your right and the other on your left in glory. In other words, oh, okay, all these things are going to happen to you. Well, what about me? I mean, that's kind of what they ask, right? He's very specific. He's going to be spit on, going to be flogged, going to be killed. Okay, hey, what about me? Can I have a really good spot in heaven then? What? And Jesus said, you don't know what you're asking, and there's a conversation that follows, but, you know, isn't it interesting that, man, that's always the challenge, right? Always the challenge for us, and the question comes back to, well, what about me? Even when Jesus was trying to get them super focused, help them understand what was about to happen, because he knew better than anyone else what a challenge that would be for them. He knew what a crisis of faith that would create for them. He knew that, in fact, says that he told them he was going to be betrayed. He knew that they would fall away on account of him. And he's trying to prepare them. And yet, we still see that little something that's, I think, in all of us, even though we see the bigger picture of what God's up to, and somehow this little lingering thought comes to the forefront of our mind at times. Well, what about me? Where am I in all that? What do I get out of that? And Jesus addresses that, and he says, basically, you don't understand, you don't know what you're asking, and that's really not to be your focus, right? Again, predicting that death. So let's turn now to chapter 11. Chapter 11 is what most probably people in my position are having their congregations turn to on this day, this Palm Sunday. Called Palm Sunday because as Jesus entered Jerusalem, some of the Gospels talk about the fact that palm branches were cut and laid on the ground for Jesus to walk in on. Palm branches were in the ancient world a sign of victory, victorious. And so we see that, but in this gospel we get this account beginning at verse 1. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' tell him, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly.' So here's the instructions. He's sending them ahead. Find this donkey, find this colt that no one's ever ridden on, and just untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you what's going on, just say, hey, the Lord needs it. Notice he said anyone. It's not just the owners, but anyone. And as it turns out, anyone does ask them about that. We pick it up at verse 4. They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, what are you doing untying that colt? In other words, you know, these are the neighborhood watch people. They're like, hey, are you stealing that donkey? What's going on? Right? They just asked because it was, you know, a little bit unusual. These are strange guys coming and taking this donkey that's tied up. They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. How they interpreted the Lord needs it, I don't know, but Jesus knew what they needed to say at the time, told them, and they executed that plan. Verse 7, when they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Now, this is a subtle thing that's maybe lost in the story, but do you realize this is an unbroken colt? Anyone here ever tried to jump on an unbroken colt? That's a little bit, you know, risky. There's usually a lot of training that has to happen before you jump on the back of a horse or a colt of a donkey. Jesus just jumps on, starts calmly walking into Jerusalem. You know, that in the hands of Jesus, that colt didn't need to have a whole process of breaking and riding. Jesus just jumped on and everything was good. So, what happens? Well, they brought the colt to Jesus, threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road while others spread branches they had cut from the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed, both those in front of Jesus and those behind him, were shouting something. Shouting, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple, and the most incredible week, the most significant week in all of history began, maybe besides creation. Most significant, and I think Alex alluded to it in our worship set, the most significant week in all of history. And by the way, that entry was a fulfillment of prophecy, a prophecy that Matthew 21 specifically talks about, but is quoting from the prophet Zechariah in the Old Testament, the prophecy about the coming Messiah. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle, and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. That was one of the messianic prophecies, that the Messiah would come riding that way. And so the specific call out of that as he enters Jerusalem is indeed a fulfillment of prophecy, and probably one that some of those who were shouting Hosanna would have recognized. They would have understood, oh yeah, that's what Zechariah talked about. Here he comes, this triumphal entry. And people honored Jesus as the Messiah. What they were shouting, the way they were worshiping him, it was appropriate for the triumphant king entering Jerusalem. He had arrived, and the fanfare to be expected with the entry of the triumphant king. And so we find Jesus now back here at Jerusalem, triumphantly entering, people worshiping him as the Messiah, people shouting out. Was it everyone? No, not everyone. Other Gospels talk about the Pharisees kind of yelling at and rebuking the disciples, tell those people to be quiet. They don't know what they're doing. And Jesus said, even if those people be quiet, all of creation, the rocks would cry out in worship to me. And so that worship was certainly appropriate. Was everyone worshiping? No. The same way, by the end of the week, was everyone calling for the crucifixion of Jesus? No, not everyone, but certainly the popular opinion had changed. And that's why it's always dangerous to rely on popular opinion. Because as has been said in the past, what is right isn't always popular, and what is popular isn't always right. And in a week's time, the popular opinion about Jesus had shifted. But we see here that things are going great, which is probably why some of the disciples said, well, this is going to be great. What position can I have in this awesome kingdom? And Jesus kept reminding them, I'm going to the cross. I'm going to the cross. God's plan, I'm going to the cross. And so what are the things we are challenged with this morning as we see this focus and this shift in this last year of public ministry in the life of Jesus? Well, I think we all have to contend with the question that Jesus asked the disciples and Peter answered, who do you say I am? That's one of the great challenges, no matter what the day or week or year is. Whether it's the last year of Jesus' public ministry or it's this year right now, we have to contend with that question. Who do you say Jesus is? What's your conclusion? What's your verdict on this one who claimed to be the Messiah? And secondly, I think, especially in his conversation with Peter, is through what lens or lenses is our vision? How do we interpret the things around us, the events, the opportunities of our lives? Do we see those with just this life in mind, or do we see a bigger picture that God is revealing to us? And when we see that bigger picture, do we honor Jesus and worship and acknowledge him as the triumphant king? I think those are the challenges for us this morning as we consider this last phase of Jesus' public ministry and his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And so where are you at in those things? What's your answer to his question, who do you say that I am? And through what lens do you view? Do you see the bigger picture of what God's up to? And is your response to that one of worship and adoration? Let's take a moment, quiet moment of reflection, right where you're at. For most people, that probably looks like I'm praying. I'm going to talk to God about these things a little bit, because I trust that in these moments, God's been at work in this place. Through his word, not my words, but through the work of the Holy Spirit, there's something going on in you in regard to the things that we've read and studied this morning. And so I want to give you an opportunity to just talk to God about that. Tell him what's going on. Reflect that back. Ask him, what do I do from here, God? What are you leading me to? What are you reminding me of? What are you teaching me that I can then apply as I go out into this week ahead? So let's pray. Give you a few moments, and then I'll close in prayer. God, this morning, once again, we're grateful to be able to come together to worship you, to spend time in your word, and to be taught and challenged by your Holy Spirit at work in our hearts and our minds. And God, I pray that you've heard from your people this morning. In these moments, as we've reflected back to you in prayer, those things that we feel are going on in our hearts, Lord, I pray that you would reinforce those things. Help us, God, to be able to see more and more through your lens, to see the bigger picture, to see what you're up to. And God, in light of those things, to be able to honor and worship you through our lives. And God, I pray that in the days ahead, Lord, you would help us to walk out our faith, to live according to your leadership in our lives, according to the standards of your word. And Lord, to be able to be those who, because we have been loved, can love others. Help us to do that, Lord. We are imperfect in that regard, but you can work perfectly through us. And so we ask that you would do that. even today, even this morning, God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and give our praise back this morning. Is built. Yeah.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Sing this out together. Christ alone.
Christ alone. Cornerstone. Weak made strong. In the Savior's love. Through the storm. He is the Lord. Lord alone. Darkness seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak and strong, in the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord.
Bye.
are Lord of all. God, we thank you that we get to celebrate knowing the end of the story, that you died, but you rose again on the third day, just like you promised, with the keys of death and sin in your hands, that we could be free, that we could know you, that we could have a relationship with you, God, and have freedom. We thank you for that this morning. It's in your mighty name we pray. Amen. Well, it was wonderful getting to worship with you guys this morning. Just wanted to remind you as you head out today, if you need prayer or just somebody to talk to, we'll have prayer partners up here front at the front who would love to talk with you. But you guys have an incredible week. We'll see you guys Friday.
And it all comes down.